couple of days ago, and he said he'd be glad to unlock the gate down there.
All right.
But he said the road's awful rough from the gate on down. I promised to carry you down there 7 or 8 years ago and never have. Go to the home place, but we can drive to where Uncle Jess' old place is.
Well, now, tell us, before we get too far into this, tell us who you are and your relation to the
Well, I'm Ray Henson, and Mr. Dick Weems married my mother when I was 8 years old in January. And we moved to Lick Creek in 1941, down on Ken Sparks' farm. And that's where I grew up, down there. And of course, if you was a Weems or around him, you were going to learn to play something, yeah, or you left home.
And that was one of my questions, is how did they get started playing this music and all? Because some of the records and things that I've read, one of the things that made them really outstanding was that some of the publications say they played like they were almost classically trained.
They taught yourself down there on the riverbank at Mousetail.
Yeah, but you see, most people, and I know our group, like playing the fiddle, most old-time fiddlers just played in that first position. They never went up the neck.
Second, third
but
position.
But now they played all the way down the neck.
Yeah, only trained orchestras, you know, in places like that did that. And nobody had a bowed cello in the band either.
That's true, yeah.
Played rhythm and bass.
That's one I wanted to ask you about,
too. Yeah, he was the celloist there.
Did he play with the bow?
Yeah, picked him playing with a bow.
Oh, get that smart.
Yeah, see, he's playing it on that picture you got there in New York.
Yeah.
Now, that picture was made almost right here in the spot where we sit.
Really?
July the 4th, 1930. It's the grand opening of the Alvin C. York Bridge out here.
I've heard about that.
Yeah. And the two boys, this is the original picture. It's in the New Yorker.
Okay, now.
Except they left off these two boys here. When
now tell me who. Tell us, can you point out who each one of these are? Yeah. Maybe Sarge, we can.
All right, that's Jack Weems.
Jack.
And that's Mr. Dick, my stepfather.
There was two fiddlers, right?
That's Uncle Frank. He was played second. This is Al Cunder. Their nephew. This is Uncle Jess Weems, and this is Dean Weems, Mr. Dick's oldest son. And that was Uncle Jess's oldest son.
I'm a dog.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, that's the same.
I've written on the back of there.
That is great.
Everybody's anybody was here that day. The governor, and there's all day. He met an airplane down here, lighting down here, and taking people for a ride in it. Charged them $1, each one of them. And they drank out here, the spring out here where Marie lives, they drank it dry that day. There's so many people here. But you got to remember one thing, that was the driest year on record, too, 1930.
Yeah.
So the spring might have been a little low to start with. But it actually happened, and that night then, of course, they had a platform here built, and they had a big dance here that night. Of course, the Weems boys played for that.
Yeah. That was another thing I was going to ask you, did they, I know a lot of the old time string bands, especially anybody that was a fiddler, played for dances. Did they have lots of dances around?
Oh yeah, every Friday, Saturday night. I mean, a lot of people had them at their house, you know.
Yeah.
School houses, and of course we played at school houses back, you know, when I was young.
I've heard stories about the house.
Every Friday night, they would dance either Polk or Pine View or Cedar Creek or somewhere, you know, back then.
Did they push the furniture around?
They cleaned the room out. It's any size at all, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
But then in the schoolhouse, you might have, you know, 20 couples out there, 15 or 20 on the floor dancing, you know, square dancing, mostly. Yeah, that was a big thing when, me and her were dating, you know.
Yeah.
We went every weekend to a dance.
Do you remember the
name? Oh, yeah.
He was still living. Miss Grant was still living when we married. No, Frank was too.
About 1957 was about the winding up, you know, of playing out in public,
But they still played around home.
At home, yeah.
Yeah.
I think, that CD that you got, that was 1957, we was up here at Mr. Dick.
Oh, okay.
When we recorded that. See, Ben, him and Junior, as Uncle Jesse's youngest son, Jesse Jr., he lived in Texas. And Ben Howard, who was Uncle Frank's grandson, they were real close. And instead of them calling each other, they had each one of them had a real, real tape recorder.
Yeah.
And they'd make each other tapes, you know, and send each other back and forth. So he got us up there that night to record that. And that was in 57. And that was, like I say, you know, about the beginning of the end, when we quit playing,
yeah.
You know, much out in the public. We didn't, we still play around home, but not, you know.
Tell me about, one of the things I really want to know about is what you know about this recording trip to Memphis.
All right, they met right over here at this big white house right out here, old Harrod house. And they went to Memphis. They thought that, you know, they'd just go down there and make that record, get paid and come home. And it was in December and it was close to Christmas. And they all went in one car. They had to tie the instrument part of them on the outside and down there. And they got down there and they wouldn't let them record it. They told them they didn't want no instrumentals, they wanted some singing.
Yeah.
Jimmy Rogers had recorded one about 6 months earlier, or a little more, and the Carter family, and they were selling pretty good, you know, had singing on.
Yeah.
And they wanted some lyrics, and some singing. And they stayed down there about 4 days, and they didn't have no money when they went. Never did have no money.
How'd they get by?
Well, on the mercy of the world, just about it. So after about 4 days, Richard Dick, of course, he was a lead band leader. They were sitting around the hotel room. He said, "I'm going down to that recording studio and get hold of that manager if I can find him." And so I'm going to find out if he's brother in the Masons. If he is, I'm going to use some masonry on him.
Yeah.
So he went down there, and sure enough, it was. Well, he put this pitiful story to him, and he finally told him, he said, "I'll tell you what I'll do." He said, "If you go back and write some lyrics, them two songs, or tunes, I'll let you record." He said, "Well, I'll have to go back to the hotel and see if, you know, if they'll let us get our instruments out, you know, we'll have to do that." So he talked to the manager at the hotel, and he said, "Yeah," said, "if you'll keep it real quiet and not disturb the, you know, the other people there in the hotel, it'll be fine." He said, "By midnight, they had half the hotel up there dancing." But then anyway, they recorded them two tunes, and they paid them, which is a little less than $100, and they come home.
That's pretty big money in those days.
But while they're down there, another little story, fun thing happened. Uncle Jess had a handlebar mustache.
Yeah.
And he was proud of it. And he said, in the hotel room there, and he said, "You know, I think he's staying there, had my hair cut with them electric clippers. They got some, that barber's got some down there in the bottom floor, ground floor there." And he said, "I'm going there to get me a haircut." Well, they bad pull pranks on each other, they always was. Or anybody else around them. And Uncle Frank and Mr. Dick one slipped around and told the other and said, "You know what? Said, we talked that barber and cut his mustache off down here." He said, "All right." And so they went down and they talked that barber and said, "Now our brother's coming down here getting hair cut," and said, "We want you to make a miss lick. Electric clippers and zip them on half his mustache off." He said, "Oh no," said, "he'll get mad." He said, "Oh yeah, he'll get mad." I said, "We won't let him hurt you." So they talked that bar to doing that.
Right.
Well, he made a miss lick there and he cut one side of his dog, and Uncle Jess come up from there fighting, throwing that apron, the thing he had over him, and he got home. Of course, he had to cut all off, you know, because he done cut half of it off. He got home and Aunt Matt, that's his wife, then she accused him of being out with another woman.
Oh.
Well, they had him round and round. She was pretty much a boss anyway around home.
Oh,
hey. He took a beating over the mustache.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Now, how many people went? How many people was in the car going to Memphis?
Well, it was Uncle Frank, Mr. Dick, and Uncle Jess, and Al, Ed Lindsay. Now, Ed Lindsay is singing on one of them songs. I can't tell which one's which. Uncle Frank sings on one of them and Ed's on the other. Now Ed, he played the guitar and he played with the Weems boys from time to time. I remember when he, you know. But him and Al, they recorded several tunes after the Weems boys did this. They recorded in Nashville for Victor. That's before his RCA Victor. I had two records of them, or two CDs that they made, but then Ed recorded some by himself even after that. I never did get any of them, but I had a couple of CDs, and I gave them to Johnny Cunder because he wanted them, and because his daddy, you know.
Yes,
and
sir.
Al, he played the banjo. Of course, he had a harmonica and a hornet's up here, and he played the harmonica and the banjo, and Ed sung, and they recorded Bo Weevil, Guns and Gold Ray Mew, and good old Turnip Greens,
man.
I forgot what was on the other side of that one, but I had two of their recordings, but I can't remember what other song was on there.
Do you know if any of the original recordings of Davy and Green MacDowell are still in existence?
Oh, you can get one from Columbia.
Well, I know, but I mean the original, like the disc.
His grandson, Bruce, got one. That's how come R. Crumb and all these people wound up with this magazine.
Yeah. Bruce, most people, I guess, would think, you know, they went to Memphis to record and they think Sun Records. This was before Sun Records.
Yeah.
This was,
and see, Dr. Wolf,
Columbia Records. Yeah.
Dr. Charles Wolf, he's the English professor, he did. Now, taught up at MTSU. I went up there twice. He got me to come up there. And he done about 15 books on early string music. He come out of the Ozarks. But they thought, see, Columbia, when they recorded that, but I'm going to Memphis, they thought they come out of the Ozarks. See, Jimmy Rogers and the Carter family, they recorded in Bristol, I think.
Bristol early set,
and they thought, you know, if they was come from the Ozarks, and they hunted for them for years and years. In 1973, Bruce, that's Mr. Dick's grandson, his youngest one, he's dead, died about 6 months, about a year ago, I guess. He wrote Columbia letter and asked him if there's any way that he could get one of those records. And he told him he's his grandson, and all that. And they said, they sent him one. And they wrote a nice letter. I read it. He still got it. Real nice letter, and said he's proud. Yeah, proud to find out where they actually come from. They hunted for them for years and years, wanted them to record more. Yes. They thought to come out of the Ozarks.
Huh.
Well, Richard Nevins, New Jersey, he owns that. Yazoo Record Company.
Yeah, I've heard of that.
He sent me two or three recordings of early string music. But anyway, he got a hold of Bruce and Harold, and come down here in 1973. And I had, me and Mr. Dick recorded about, I think it was six songs, tunes. Parsons over here, the little old, Feller had a little old home recording thing upstairs in his house there.
Yeah.
And Jack Weems, he was a real good friend of this guy over there, and he got us over there, and we made, I believe it was either five or six records.
Mm-hmm.
And they only give us one. What it was, Mr. Dick had wrote about four songs or tunes, but he never had wrote any words to them, just the music, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy, Scotty, I got a picture of him here. He played the fiddle a little bit. He wasn't that great, but he could fiddle a little.
Oh, those are pictures I hadn't seen.
I haven't seen.
And, that was him right here. And he had this recording studio, and his wife was kind of in the music business, and he got us over there to record them. She's going to write words to them.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if she ever did or not. We got that one record, and it's on one of them. It's on that CD there. It's Billy in the Low Ground, and on the other side of it was Lonesome Widow.
Oh, hey.
And they gave us that one that night, but we recorded the four that he wrote, and I know we recorded Wild Bill Cheatham on another one, and I don't remember what was on the other side of it.
This is him when he was, what, 18?
Yeah, I was about 17, 18, yeah.
And this is
I played the old cello. I didn't bow it. I picked it, though.
Yeah, and a lot of people do that.
Now, this guitar here, Mr. Dick bought me that when I was 13-year-old up there at Tiller. That's a K guitar.
A large top, yeah.
Yeah, when I was 13-year-old, and by the time I got 14, I was playing in a band with them.
Do you know where they got their fiddles? Were they homemade fiddles? Or
No. That fiddle that Mr. Dick's playing there, his daddy bought him that fiddle. No, that's one that Al gave him there, because it's got a white peg on it. Al Cunder gave him that fiddle in 1942. It was unglued all over. He brought it over where we live in there, Mr. Ken Sparks's, and he glued the thing back together. Bruce's wife, well, Nick's got it now, Nick Weems. But his other fiddle, German Steiner, his daddy got him at when he was 9 years old. Now he played, he learned his, he, that's him right here. Now he's playing that, that's one day I'll get him. Here you got a good picture of him.
Yeah.
He's laying right flat at his back. He's 7 year old under the bed. His daddy kept his fiddle on the bed where he stored it. And he's laying there flat at his back. And he learned, he struck a tune on Mississippi Sawyer.
Oh, yeah, that's one of my favorites.
Or Downfall and Perish, what some people call it, one, some or other.
Yeah.
But he struck that tune and playing it, and his mother heard him. And he crawled out among that bed, and she let him get out among there, that fiddle, and he played it around there. And he said, can I play it when he come home for dinner? They're all out in the field working, you know. He farmed, and he'd been. Grandpa Tom had a blacksmith shop, too. And she said, yeah. I said, after they eat dinner, I said, lunch, I said, you get the fiddle out for him. So they all eat lunch. She said, I want to show you all something. She set him up in the chair, and he wasn't allowed to touch him fiddle. See, I mean, he was too young. They were particular about their instruments, you know. She set him up in the chair, and he crawled up there, and he cut loose on that song or tune. And from that day on, he could get the fiddle out anytime he wanted to and play it. So when he was 9, he bought him a German Steiner, and his granddaughter down at Camden, she's got it now. But it's pretty, it's tiger strap, you know, and maple tiger strap, or we're going to call the back of it and all, it's pretty.
Yeah.
It's a smaller feeling, it's not as loud as that one, but he liked that one better than he did the other one. But Al gave him that old fiddle there, and it was unglued all over, and it's got one white peg or screw on it, and the rest of them is.
Now, you mentioned some of the tunes. And I'm familiar with most all of them that you mentioned.
Yeah.
We played a lot of them ourselves. What were some of their popular tunes of the day that they played for, like Square Dance?
Oh, Lord, he could sit and play all night long and not ever play the same one twice.
What were some of the, can you remember any of the names of some of the tunes?
Oh, yeah, Leather Breeches, Texas Gallop, Buckhorn Hound and Barlow Blade, Old Joe Clark, Bill Cheatham, Leather Breeches. Old Hen Chicago. Jump Jim Crow.
Yeah.
Now there was a colored man that lived up on Lick Creek above us. Every time he come down to Patterson's store, which is down below there, he'd have him play that, and that was the dancingest little feller I ever seen. He could jump red straight up and pop his heels together and not ever miss a lick. But he always had him play at Jump Jim Crow.
Yeah.
Yeah. But now his all-time favorite was Billy and the Lowground.
Oh yeah,
he played that in the Fiddler's Contest. I hated it. I played it with him, but in fact, it's on that CD. I had a record of it we made over there, but I didn't really hate it. But it wasn't one of my favorites. But he liked it. I liked Bill Cheatham and Lonesome Widder. And
you got something here.
Yes, and I don't. This was given to me. But I haven't heard anything at all about it. But it was in with the some other information I got. Are you familiar with this at all?
What, I don't know. What is it?
It's, and I don't know, but I got it. Are you familiar with that?
Yeah, that's the words on that. Davy.
That's part of Davy?
Yeah, that's Davy. Yeah, that's the words on Davy.
That's what I thought it looked like.
Oh, so that's part of...
Yeah, that's the words of it, yeah.
That was the first record, Green Bay Dollar
and Davy.
Davy,
on the other side.
I didn't know this is the part of Davy that I had heard, but I had never heard.
Bear in mind, this was the 1920s, so...
I told you that...
Right, today wouldn't work, would be politically incorrect, but this was the 1920s, and that was different times.
Well, now, they got the words wrong here. It said, Davy, poor little Davy, down on the hill. So it's supposed to be down in the kitchen,
cooking up gravy,
yeah.
So this was the last part? I thought the title was Hokey Cokey.
No, Davy, that's the right title, but they got the words a little bit off here. And down on the hillside, that's not in there. Down in the kitchen.
Well, it's this greenback dollar, and I don't remember where I got this, but it was given to me.
Down the holler, all I want's a greenback dollar. You know, that became very...
Yeah, that's right there.
And they wrote the words to that.
Both of them, yeah.
You know, Greenback Dollar became a very popular old time and even in the bluegrass.
Yeah, they some of them plays it now, you know.
Yeah.
That John, what's his name, that plays
John
it?
Hartford?
Yeah, he plays it pretty often. And they tell me over in Australia that Davy is real popular over there.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah, that's a good one. I
liked it really better than the, you know, the Bill. You have to blank out there, leave the words all that one time.
Well, but, nobody said anything to me when we played over here at Glass and Genial.
He gave a friend.
I don't know if anybody noticed, but I did take the words to the last verse.
Did you ever hear of MacDonald Craig?
Oh, yeah. We played with MacDonald.
Well,